לא נפריע עם השיחה.
זה אנשים שמצטרפים, נכון? פתחת אותי? כן. היי, שלום לכולם. Hello, Francois, how are you?
Very fine, and you? You are Daniel?
Yes, I'm Nassaf with me here. We are the crew. Nice to meet you for the first time for us as well, from, unfortunately, from far away. But then I think it's the first great adventure for our clients to meet you together for the first time with them. So then it's an amazing opportunity. And I'm very glad that we could make it. And it's great. Really great honor for us. I will let you speak mostly. You. I will you give too. You the order of the wine and the wines we taste. And we will do it one by one. You can, if you want the maps, we can put up the maps. And if you want anything else, we can provide you by the media. We can do it with pleasure.
So, great, thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me to this tasting. Maybe, do you want a short story about the domain before we start or
so
whatever?
We are actually waiting for the last clients to come up with us. So we will just give them three minutes. Most of them are already with us and they have all the small bottles at home to taste the wines with us. We divided today the bottles to 13 clients, which will taste, as you see, from the 50 milliliter.
Ah, all right.
So everyone you speak with are tasting the wine. So it's not like some Zoom that they only come to know you and the domain. They will all taste the wines. The wines that we will taste today will be the Savigny Le Bon au Fourneau. We will taste the Pernon Vergelès, Ile de Vergelès, Rouge. We will taste the Corton Clos du Roi. And for the white, we will taste the Corton Blanc and the Pernod Vergelès, Ile de Vergelès sans soufre.
Okay, it's all 18, huh?
No, actually Corton Blanc is 2017 and also the Ile de Vergelès. 17. Also
Blanc
the white.
Is 17 too?
Yeah.
Okay. Great, thank you. All right.
Okay. I will say just something small on Hebrew for the clients and presentation. אז קודם כל, שמחים לראות את כולכם שוב, טעימה מיוחדת, פעם ראשונה אנחנו תואמים יחד איתכם את היינות, זה פעם ראשונה גם בשבילנו שאנחנו תואמים את היינות האלה, כאן, מה שהגיע לארץ, שתינו בעבר. בנוסף, בסיום הטעימה, כיוון שיש לנו עוד יין, שאתם רואים גם אצלכם, שמגיע מיקב אחר, אנחנו נטעם אותו בסוף. אחרי, אנחנו נתחיל עם שני הלבנים, נעבור לאדומים שלו, ונסיים עם הלבן מהיקב השני, גם יקב, זה כבר יקב, כמו שאתם רואים, אתם מקבלים את ההצעה, היקב השני שנטעם, תוכלו גם להביע את דעתכם, האם בכלל אתם חושבים, אנחנו כבר טעמנו, ויש לנו דברים, ניסיון נחמד מאוד איתו, נספר גם קצת עליו, היינן כאן, פרנסואה, זה משפחה עתיקת יומין, הוא ידבר על הכל במקום מדהים, חלק ממכם היו בשנדון דה בריאי, אני חושב. אני אישית לא הייתי, האמת, אני מאוד אוהב את היינות, לעולם לא ביקרתי ביקב, הם הצליח להיות איזשהו קשר ונפלאות הקורונה, הנה אנחנו מייבאים יקב בלי שאפילו היינו שם.
תוכלו להראות רק את היינות שאתם מתאימים, כי...
בטח.
כן, נראה כמובן את התוויות לפני
ש... בסדר גמור. תודה רבה.
מעולה, אז אנחנו מחכים בעצם, נכון? אוקיי. Francois, any maps you will need? You will need the Corton map and Savigny-le-Bon and Pernand-de-Vergelès?
Yeah, why not if you have them? That great, would be grateful, I think. Right?
Excellent. Better.
Would you prefer to taste with the La Vie en Belle or you prefer to taste start with the Corton Blanc?
You're starting with the whites?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Or you prefer to start with the red and then move to the whites?
Usually that's what we do in Burgundy.
Okay. All right.
We usually start with the reds. And then with the whites.
We go by you. So then it's the Savigny-le-Bon, Pernand-Vergelès, Clos du Roi, that will be the order?
I think so, yeah.
All right, perfect. So
What is the Pernand Île de Vergelès you have? It's the classical Pernand Île de Vergelès sans soufre, 17?
Yes, the white, yes. It's 2017, okay. Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Then we'll do this one, and then we can end by the Corton Blanc.
All right. So then we can do the Savigny, Pernand Vergelès Rouge, Clos du Roi, yeah. Pernand Vergelès Sans Soufre, and the Corton Blanc.
Right, yeah. Yes.
That's so we will put now, just for all our clients, the label that they will start with us.
Very nice, yeah.
So you can start by representing the domain, and you have actually, you know, we will put you in the center and you can explain about you, about the domain, about the history a bit, and give the presentation and everything.
Okay, sure. The story about this familial domain that is in the family since 1834 has been run by different directors from this time up to the 80s. All my family was living in Paris. They were coming at the domain sometimes, quite often a year, but they were not running it by themselves. The first who started was running the domain family member was my mother in the early 80s, because the domain was not doing very good, quite bad actually. And she decided to run by herself and to rebuild this nice domain of 14 hectares that is located in Savigny-le-Bon. It's northern part of Côte de Beaune. It's 4 kilometers north from Beaune. And that owns part of Savigny-le-Bon village and Premier Cru, and also vineyards on Pernand-Vergelès, which is just the next village, very, very close to Savigny, but different terroirs with Pernand-Île-de-Vergelès, Pernand-les-Vergelès also, red and white. And after we have several vineyards on the hill of Corton, it's a very well-known hill, where we have one Premier Cru, which is Alos Corton, Premier Cru de Valosière, and several Grand Cru reds like Corton Maréchaud, Corton Bressand, Corton Clos du Roi, and several whites also, as long as Corton Blanc and Corton Charlemagne. Voilà, it's the historical part of the domain. My mother came early 80s and she tried to understand what was going on in the viticulture, and she was not very glad with the chemical products. So she stopped all the herbicides and all pesticides in 88. So she turned into organic culture for the whole domain, but was not certified. Then in 2001, I was a distributor of wines in Paris and a wine shop also. But she called me and she said she wanted to retire and she asked me to come over with my sister Claude. And I said, it's a nice challenge. And I was very pleased to come over. And I had some ideas about biodynamic as long as I distributed wines from other wineries in Paris that were doing it, done in biodynamic system. And I was convinced by this way of cultivating vineyards. So in 2005, I decided to turn on biodynamic on the whole domain, on the 14 hectares. And it went quite well. Voilà. This is where we are now. We went a little further with cultivating the soils with horses. We plow the soils with horses since 2014. 10 hectares upon 14. We don't use any more sulfur on the vines against powder mildew, but we use skimmed milk, which is more natural and goes very well. And we do the harvest by hand, of course, all of them, with a good, very good and precise selection of the grapes. Because after we do the vinifications with the whole grape, 100% whole grape, and very natural, we don't use any sulfites on the vinifications. And then after that, the wines are aged in barrels on their lees without sulfite still for about 14 to 20 months. It depends on the vintages. And then it goes for bottling with a very, very low sulfite added. I mean, it's like 2 grams per hectoliter, so it's very low. And we do some cuvée that you will taste in white, but there are some in red also. We do some little cuvée with nothing added, no sulfite, nothing. It's all natural. Voilà, this is the story about the domain, and I think we can start. The tasting, if you want.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
So it's great to hear. I mean, you don't give yourself too much compliment, but for me, it was great honor because for me, it's a really, really big name and a very historical name. And I actually drank one. I remember one of the greatest wines I had from Burgundy was the Clos de Roy 79. It was magical. It was really, we got it blind. It was phenomenal. I had 88 Pernan Vergeles Rouge also from me, and it was my vintage, 88 Pernan Vergeles Red, and it was really great as well. And I think the wines are aging.
The device will be ready to connect. The device player is successful.
It's to you. It's for on your computer, but it's fine. Then it's really, really, really great, great, great wines that can age amazing for me. And tasting them young is actually this young vintage is first for me, as I haven't been at the domain before, but I hope very soon again. So
I hope so.
The house is very beautiful. Also, that everyone know, it's an amazing place. And so we can start with the Savigny Le Bon au Fourneau. We can give you the map as well, so you can we can direct the location and everything. So as gam lekulam, Savigny Le Bon au Fourneau ze hayin harishon she'anachnu nitam. Zoom.
So Savigny Le Fourneau is down the hill. It's the bottom of the hill on the northern part of Savigny.
Okay. You share it now?
Yes.
Yeah. Great. You see everyone?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So this one, yeah?
Yes. Sorry, I'm on. Yes, that's it. Yeah, so as you can see, there is on this Sauvignon Fourneau, there are two parts. The upper part, as you can see, is classified with Premier Cru.
Yeah.
And the bottom, the really bottom of the hill, next to the road, is a village. So the purple one is Premier Cru, and the green one is village. And we have a vineyard that goes from the one road to the other.
So from south to north, or
yeah,
okay,
yeah, it's that it's south to north. You have on the right of the map, on the right of the appellation of Fourneau, we have about here, we have down there and up there, so the green and the purple one part.
So the
means
green
that
the purple.
We have. Yeah. Yeah, we have 1/3 of the vineyards which is classified village and 2/3 which is classified premier cru. If you see what I mean. It's just because I want to explain the cuvée. As long as we blend the village and the premier cru since this vintage, since 18. Before we used to separate.
The declassification. Premier Cru to village.
Yeah, we declassify the 2/3 of the cuvée into the village. I mean, it's a good image for the domain to make a very good village, a higher level village, to start with, because all the other wines in the domain are Premier Cru or Grand Cru. And I think the blend had a good made sense on the tasting. Because it's completed very well between the very deep clay soils, and upper the hill you have more limestones, and when you blend the whole cuvée, it makes really sense. So that's why we decided to do it since 2018 actually. Yeah.
2018 is the first vintage to make it. Wow.
Yeah, first vintage that's for amazing. Blending. Before we had
you really have. Yeah, you really have much more structure and complexity than the regular village. I had
the Sauvigny-le-Bon.
And here you see that it, wow. I mean, even for, it was like I said, okay, single vineyard village, and you taste and really the complexity of the fruit, and you have a lot of tension still, and it gives the wine, I think it's a really young,
really young one. Yeah, it can age beautifully.
Cool. I think we had the better balance with the blend. Right.
Yep. Yeah. It's really. It's not. Let's say it's not the usual Sauvigny-le-Bon you get from a village, because sometimes it's a little bit more. For me, it's a little bit more. Maybe green. Maybe tight. Not tight, but the tart. Tart. The fruit is a little bit more tart, and here you get a little bit more ripeness. Of course, 18, but still, I think the vineyard and the declassification really shows off in the glass.
Yeah, it's a perfect mix.
Yeah.
And it's nice because for me, we had actually in our portfolio, the only Sauvigny-le-Bon we have is the Sauvigny-le-Bon of Mio, Jean-Marc Mio, Alix Mio.
Yep.
So it's great to have also all the range from the old domain and having Sauvigny-le-Bon. And I think for sure, this is the most important house of Sauvigny-le-Bon and one of the most important in the Côte d'Ebon.
Of course.
For sure. So that's great. And how would you compare it to the regular Sauvigny-le-Bon? From which vineyards they are? It's the regular Sauvigny-le-Bon, the village cuvée?
You mean comparatively to
Which Liodi, from which Liodi is coming the Sauvigny-le-Bon? From many?
Sorry, I'm not sure I understand.
Yeah. The Fourneau is I understand, but the other cuvée, the village, the
what you have done in
General Sauvigny-le-Bon.
What?
It's from which vineyards in Sauvigny-le-Bon? It's a mix and blend of many Liodi of Sauvigny-le-Bon village.
You mean the other Sauvigny village from other producers?
From you?
No, from you. From you. What you have
from us? From the domain? From No, no, from the domain, we only have this first cuvée, which is Savigny Ofono. We don't have any other.
So in 2017, you made the Premier Cru Forno and Village Forno. And you didn't mark Forno on the Village.
No, no, because it's too complicated. And so we decided not to call it Forno, just Village.
Okay.
And it's a good wine, but less interesting compared to the blends. You have much less complexity on the aromatic on the bottom of the vine.
Yeah, so, it was much more approachable and easy.
Exactly, light a little
bit. Here is very nice. You really have a nice structure, still a lot of red fruit for 2018. Yeah. And it's although the tannins are you have the structure of the tannins, but it's still very pleasant.
Yes, very pleasant. The tannins are very fine, especially as we're tasting quite a lot Côte de Bon recently, and we do find the tannins are totally different than the Côte de Nuit. And here we get such a fine Côte de Bon tannins, because they're a little bit, they're in front, but they're almost silky tannins. And I think that's why the wine is in great balance at this young stage.
And can you tell us?
18 is tasting quite easily, and we do a whole grapes vinification. So when you have the blend with Savigny Les Fourneaux, you have a big part of Premier Cru. It's quite important for doing the vinification with whole grapes. It helps a lot, and it gives a nice complexity of the aromatics. And as you say, the texture is quite silky and easy drinking.
And how is the 2018 in general? It was for you the harvest, the year, the winter, the spring, summer, until harvest.
That was a complicated vintage. It was very hot during the summer. We had quite a good yield actually, and it ripened quite fast at the end. So the date for picking was very important, not to be overripe. And not to be underripe also. So it was a little complicated with so much grapes to pick up, but I think we made it well. And the vintage is not the same everywhere, but at the domain, I think we took the good part of the vintage. That makes wines that are very approachable young. I guess they can age very well also. And we have a nice freshness for such a hot vintage. That's what I think. Right?
Yeah, that's really nice.
I think the Vendage Entière, the whole clusters are probably the main key in 18. Because once you maintain the healthy clusters, the fruit and the wine will be very fresh. I think it's. For me, it is approachable at the moment, but still the structure, the acidity, all in very high tension. And I believe that the wines are just will age forever. Gracefully and amazing. Really.
I really think, you know, as well, seeing here 2018 is wonderful for us because these wines will arrive soon to Israel from all the winemakers we work with. We are about to finish to sell the 2017s. And really, that's a great presentation also for us to see the 2018s. And I think you said something very interesting because you said it was really... it was the goal to harvest without too much alcohol, but then not to harvest too early to get these green notes. And I think today is the most difficult thing because in the history, you know, you were waiting until it's, you know, the ripeness is coming. And today people are really running sometimes to the vineyards really early. And in the end, we get something very fresh from hot vintages, but the phenolic ripeness is not there.
Sure. I think it's a problem with the global warming also. It goes very fast at the end of the ripeness. So the tension is here when we start harvesting. And in 18 and 19 also, even in 20, it was always the same problem, is that when do we start and when do we end? We must make it quite fast. So we have to employ a lot of people to make it fast, actually.
And how do you fight the way, and how do you see the way when it is the phenolic ripeness is coming for sure?
I mean, we always taste the grapes, huh? I go in the vineyards and I taste all the berries, all the grapes as much as I can. And well, with the experience, it's been like 20 years of doing wine, and now I know quite well when it's ripe, rightly ripe.
What was your first vintage?
I started 2001. I was settled in the domain, but I started the harvest much before. I was coming every vintage. So my very first one was 88.
Wow. Nice. So we can move on for the Pernam Vergeles. And those in the map of Pernam Vergeles, we can move on to taste the Pernam Vergeles, the Ile de Vergeles. Usually, I think, and actually, I think here people know more Pernam Vergeles for the white wines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Usually, yeah. Because we have here in Israel De Monti making Din Du Monti some the Pernam Vergeles, and we used to have some as well from Rappé in white, but not much of red. And I've tasted some reds, and they are really interesting, but I think we are not very familiar with the terroir of Pernam Vergeles.
I understand very well this. First of all, Pernam Vergeles is a very small area in global for this appellation, and if you are very near the village of Pernam Vergeles, which is in a valley, you have
I'm gonna show the map wind. Right now.
Why not? So this village is quite cold in climate, because you can see there is a valley coming from the north and blowing very cold wind on the vines that are very near the village. So that's where you have mainly the whites. But if you go further south, you will find areas better for reds. Nearby Savigny. Yeah, absolutely. Means that you can see where your arrow is. It's our part of Ile de Vergeles. We have 4 hectares over there. It's just mid hill facing east. It's where there is the it's a little bit more on the left. We have the first part south of the vineyard, upper the road. Now it's just upper.
Oh,
Ile des Hautes. This is Basse Vergeles, but upper, this is Ile des Hautes Vergeles. It's the old name. Huh? The new name is Ile des Vergeles. And we have the first 4 hectares on the south part. And it's mid-hill facing east with a very balanced terroir with clay and limestones. It's a dry terroir, and it's a fantastic terroir, which is much warmer than the other ones nearby the village of Pernon, which makes wines that can be nicely ripe if you wait enough before harvesting. And it was supposed to be classified Grand Cru in 1937.
Wow.
At the end, they did not. But to me, it's quite near Grand Cru. I mean that this wine is quite masculine, strong, but with good finesse and nice aromatic, and more on the spices like pepper. But it ages very, very, very nicely.
It's really interesting, an amazing structure. I mean, yeah. And it really has spiciness, and it's like a lower alcohol even than the Savigny, but you feel the mouth feeling is big, and you feel a bit more sweetness, and you have like and you have like kind of slight bitterness with iron infused inside, and you have the minerals, you yes. have the sweetness, you have the fruit, you have, it's a bit more fat than the Sauvignon. It's wow,
yes,
wow,
it
that's really, really, really impressive. I had it, I had the 88 vintage and it was terrific, but cool. Now tasting this one, it's 30 years after, and this is really, really fascinating. I mean, the yeah. part in the tongue when it comes, and this kind of almost bloody metally finish.
Yeah. The finish wow. is really mineralic, because you almost yeah. don't feel no fruit, but the spices, saltiness, and the dry extract just creates a very unique finish. A finish you find in a very mineral parcels, I think, in Burgundy, when it finish sharp.
But you have ripeness as
and you
well.
You have still the ripeness, yes. Mm-hmm.
It's kind yes. of Piemonte bit. You know, if you would put Piolo there, you could make it really Piemontese, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah, it's kind of. It's
very similar mineral.
Yeah, it's a kind of Barolo.
A Barolo.
Burgundy like Barolo kind of, yeah. with a lot of fresh, of course, and still very Pinoy. But
there's a really structure, right?
Yeah.
And saltiness at the end. I'm okay with this, absolutely. You know, but what means île in French? It's island.
Yeah.
And island here in this case means the best part of a terroir.
Yeah. Wow.
It's really, voilà, it's like paradise, you know. So wow. that's a specific terroir. We really love this fantastic terroir.
Then I have to, and here. All the work is by horses.
And all the work here in the Pernod Île-de-Vergelès is made with the horses since 2014.
Wow, amazing. And what
and it do makes you, what, soils what, very alive. It's very interesting to do that. And you can see that the soils are so much alive. It's crazy. And it brings to the plant and then to the grapes much more energy.
That's very impressive. Really, really impressive wine. And I mean, for those you know, even a young client of Burgundy mm-hmm. that doesn't have the funds to pay too much on wine and want to start to build kind of cellar or to age wine, that is
amazing wine to
masterpiece to age, yes. because it cannot get to too high price because of it's still Pernod Vergelès, but then you have the quality of really Grand Cru quality. It's really...
I think so, right?
Yeah.
Very special, huh? I mean, you don't have in the wines this kind of too much extravagant Vendage Entière
yes.
style.
Yes.
I mean, it's a very clean, precise, yeah. and have a lot of finesse, because sometimes, you know, you have all this brownish yeah. and all the smells and everything. And here you have like, it's using the Vendage Entière to gain freshness, to make a lot of things.
Would you mind tell us a bit about vinification and about the wines? Yeah.
Yeah, because when you're talking about that, about these whole clusters vinifications, it's quite complex because it depends on the vintages, but you must be very smooth with the extraction. If you don't want your wines to taste herbal, you've got to be very careful. So we have, for the harvest, we have 7 people for 6 rows. Means that I have 6 pickers and 1 guy for 6 rows that takes care of the other ones and takes care of the quality of the grapes that comes into the cases. Means that if one picker or two or any picker does not the job properly, the guy would tell him, please make a better selection on the grapes. The thing is that Pinot Noir, you know, this grape is very fragile, actually. If you take it too many times in your hands, there is juice coming out, and then the problems are coming with this. So there is no selection made in the cuverie. It's all made in the vineyards on one time. When the grapes are in the bucket, then it goes in cases and nobody touch the grapes. And then it comes into the winery and by cases, and we take these cases up and we put the grapes directly in the wooden tanks, classical Burgundy style, you know, with this big tanks made of wood. And then we put all the grapes inside. We usually have a small cuve that has started before, which we call a pied de cuve. And then we use one bucket of juice of this started cuve to start the new one that we have just entered, because we want the fermentation to start very fast. It's very important that the grapes must be totally alive when they start fermenting. There is no moisture, no problem with this. And we cover the tank, and then it starts. We let it go like this for about 5 days, and then we open up the tank, and we do some pigeage and remontage and all what is required for vinifications, but always adapted with the vintage. It's always different, it's never the same. And then it lasts about 10 or 15 days more. We go to the end of the sugar when it's all finished, and then we take out the juice and we put the solid parts into a vertical press. And it's new also, this vertical press. We started in 2014 with this vertical press, which gives a much better juice than the other ones. And then we can blend the two parts of the juices, and we wait for about 2, 3, or 4 days that it ends the sugars, and then it goes down in the cellar by gravity. At this time, we have not added any sulfite.
And then for how long is the élevage? How long time in the barrel?
It would stay on the lees in the barrels for about 14 to 20 months. Depends on the cuvée and depends on the vintages also.
All right. And the percentage of the, with which tonnellerie?
Good question. So we are not fond of new oak. We use very small part. I mean, on the village, on the premier cru, we use between 10 to 15% of new oak. And the other ones are from 2 to 10 years old. And for the Grand Cru, we use 20-25% new oak. And that's all. And our tonnellerie is mainly cava. They don't burn too much the woods, and it let the wines quite fresh on the fresh aromas and not on the smoky side, you know.
I'm very happy to hear. My great, very, very, very close friends.
Who?
The Cava family.
Are we? You know them?
Really great friends of us, visiting us at least twice a year in Israel, having a lot of parties in Israel, in Paris and everywhere.
Oh, so, right. Funny.
Yeah, yeah.
Pierre and Henri, right? They're very nice guys. Also, I started with the father.
With Charles.
To Charles.
Right. Yes, and yeah, with the old place, with the nice place close to Dijon. And that's so nice, so nice. And you know, I what I love in the style is really tasting these three wines. They are so elegant. I mean, they have all clusters, which usually you taste and the wine is a bit green or a bit open and is a floral and used to make something, you know, from that. And here it's very elegant, it's very precise, red fruit, silky, and I always like the wines, and here tasting them so young, it's so beautiful, and having this trio of 2018, really understanding everyone, you know, speak about 18, big vintage, huge, you cannot drink the wines, they are too heavy. And here we have this really a nice experience having these beautiful 18s, seeing all the freshness of this vintage with some red fruit, with nice floral notes, with flowers, with a nice acidity, with all this taste that we love in every classic vintage. And sometimes we speak about maybe 16, 10, you know, here.
Yeah.
You know, okay. But then I really love them.
They really feel like classic Burgundy vintage. The wines are structured with a very good acidity. The complexity is amazing. And again, it's the structure against the silkiness and balance of the wine.
And here you really have everything from the terroir. Yeah. Everything is like coming from the terroir. Yeah. Everything coming from the land. The land is like, you know, so outside here. Tasting this Corton, you can really feel after Savigny, Pernin Vergelès, Corton. And we need to mention, these three villages are just nearby each other. And
the differences between each other is so amazing.
We really move on. We can say that we move on for our last red, the Corton Clos du Roi. Yep. And you can tell Corton. Us about the vineyard of the king, the Clos du Roi, the Clos of the king. And as well, you know, it's a wine. I only smelled it, but it already gives a lot of happiness.
Such an intense wine. Such a
powerful
aromatic wine. Very, very aromatic for me. Wow. Very complex on the palate. The tannins are magic, really. Just magic. I think we are not used to drink this kind of Côte de Bon on this
2018 Côte. Speaking like a wine we should taste in 100 years, usually. Yeah. And then we should have it here and enjoy so much.
Yeah, no, it's easy to taste, and the vintage is quite cool for drinking the wines young. I like so much the 18s. So Corton is complex, it's complicated because it's a big hill. You have a big area in Grand Cru. For the reds, it's more than 100 hectares. So I know it's complicated, but at the Domaine, we have, as I told you, Les Cortons Les Maréchaux, which is just under the mid-hill. And then on the mid-slope, we have Cortons Les Bressandes, which is very typically Corton, Bressandes and Renard, which are quite wild style of wine, but we love it. And on the top of the Bressandes, upper the Bressandes, and quite high on the hill, we have this Corton Clos du Roi. Voilà. But ours is really on the highest part. Yes, about there. Yeah, yeah, definitely. It's just around here. And it's 320 meters altitude, which is very high for the Grand Cru. But the terroir here is quite fantastic. It's quite the same as the Corton Charlemagne, a little darker, but it's mainly limestones. It's a white, what I call white marls. It's limestone mainly, and it gives a wine that is, it has the power of Corton, but it's more Côte de Nuit style.
Yes.
More dark fruit.
Yeah.
It's black fruit, so it's more on the style. But on the nose, it's quite floral because of this of these limestones. We have a more floral style on the nose, and to me, it's quite charming. It's even easier than Corton Bressan to taste.
I think the wine is stunning. You know, it's huge. It's floral. It's really has this kind of beautiful rust, even from the color and the taste and the smell.
Exactly.
And you feel so much flowers, and the structure of the tannins is really beautiful, and it's really mouth coating, but it's really all the power without mass.
Exactly.
Usually in Corton, we have power, mass, structure. And here is like the great Côte de Nuit, is like amazing wine with not a big structure.
and you have it like more lean, but with floral, with rust, with complexity, with but you feel this wine is more mineral.
Yes, definitely, of course.
Once the saliva is so strong, it's like there's almost like a feeling that the finish is gonna end, but then it just comes back right up with tons of salt, nice red and black fruits, and it's a really, really long palate. And I think for our clients, it's amazing to taste those kinds of 2018, because I think it's the first 2018 tasting we're doing, and come by this elegant Côte de Beaune 2018, after all the 2017 Côte de Nuit tasting we did, I think it's a great...
It's a great vision
of the 2018 in front of 2017.
And I think as well, what is great in these three wines, you have no gemminess.
Nothing.
You don't have anything come inside. The saliva is not coming inside, and you have that, you know, sometimes we feel that our saliva is coming back in the mouth, and it's feeling like it's coming more fat, and it's staying. And here, fresh. Yeah. Freshness, it's no gemminess, so beautiful, and without, and the wine are not green at all. There is no green notes, no green pepper of any kind, not anything greeny, not green florality.
Not green tannins. Not green tannins because of the Vendange Entière. Sometimes
red fruit, it's a party of fruits, which I assume it would be more black and more big. And then I feel so much freshness. And it's like every sip I drink, I am ready for the next one.
It really reminds me of...
That's what we want. We want to drink a lot.
Côte de Nuit, because they're very mineral.
It's like Clos de Vougeot next to the Chateau.
Exactly, Clos de Vougeot next to the Chateau. Something around Vougeot, which is still floral, spicy, just combines Vaughan Romanée and Vougeot together. Mm. So, you know, but still, this is Corton.
And still I found this kind of like the greatest Piemonte wines having slight touch in this area, but on the good side of it.
Yes. I think we're thinking about
the Roania, Conterno, Lotto, good wine, you know.
Yeah, I love this wine.
Yeah. So then we can say that we tasted lately few 18s Côte de Beaune, and they were really surprising. Usually we had some Côte de Beaune also from Volnay and Pomar, and in our tastings from Angerville and Clerget and some other ones. And we are really surprised by the power and the freshness of the Côte de Beaune 18s.
Yes.
And I think they will be really nice also for drink on the young side some, but they will be unbelievable as well for aging. So I'm really surprised having this young Burgundy Côte de Beaune, which we taste another two 18s lately, this week, and seeing
this day
that 18 is a phenomenal vintage that we can really enjoy from. Like, you know, I was really afraid. I mean, everybody gonna buy these 18s and pop up and pour and having like too much structure and the big wines and very difficult. But I mean, from what we tasted until now, like it was for me, In the barrel tasting, we tasted 2018 and they were really big in the barrel.
Mm-hmm.
But then in the bottle, they became something so fresh, so nice, so beautiful, even much more than 15. That 15 was in the bottle,
barrel
was nicer, but here, I think we have more tension than we had in 15.
Yes, I think the tannins are a little bit more finer. I think they're finer because the wines a touch more approachable at the moment, because I think 15, once they were in bottle, they were almost undrinkable because of the tannins. They were really, really powerful and tannic wines. And I think 18 are powerful, tannic, yet less tannic than 15 and more attention on the outside.
Less fat. What can you tell us about... What about... how the 18s become with this kind of freshness? Is it with the acidity? No. You have like a really fresh acidity behind, even with this volume and the hot year and this kind of big vintage?
It's quite surprising, but I think that as long as we had a big yield, the maturity went not too high. I think it helped a lot in this kind of vintage. Otherwise, the balance is quite incredible. On the paper, the acidity is low, but tasting the wines is quite fresh. So I think there are 2 points: the yield and then the fermentation of this whole cluster. That makes the wines fresher, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, a really treat. If somebody, אם יש לכם שאלות או עוד שאלה, ראיתי פה שאלנה שאלה שאלה וגם מיכל קצת קודם, ואם יש לכם עוד שאלות לגבי האדומים, אם יש לכם עוד דברים שאתם רוצים להוסיף לפני שאנחנו עוברים איתו לכיוון הלבנים, זה הזמן, זמן טוב לשאול שאלות. אם אתם רוצים, לא חובה, אנחנו ממש יכולים גם להמשיך הלאה. באופן אישי, אני מאוד התרשמתי מהעינות, בלי שישמע, מקסימים, וממש ממש יופי של 2018, ועכשיו עם כל המחירות שאנחנו עושים של 2018, רק מראה לנו שהי, זה לא רק, זה גם כולנו יכולים לקנות 2018 ואפשר לשתות אותם גם בגיל יותר צעיר, כנראה מכל הריינג', אז הולכת להיות לנו נראה לי שנה מאוד מעניינת עם 2018. אז we will move on for the I just said that we're going to have I think a very interesting year with the 2018s. How was the 2019 volumes for you? Less than 18?
No, much less. Mm-hmm. 19 is a 60%, 50 to 60% yield, so it's quite less, and it was hot, so the 19s are very intense, very rich, but very nice also, different. I just wanted to add that when you can have this balance in the wines in specific vintages, hot vintages or cold vintages, we must not forget that running the vines in biodynamic makes a difference, definitely. I realized that when we started in 2005. And also all the work we do with the horses and all that stuff makes that even in difficult vintages, you can get a nice balance with your wines. We are 11 people working for 14 hectares here in the domain, which is very, very much compared to other domains that use like 3 or 4 people to do the same, to do the job. And you add 5 horses and it's quite a big team.
That's amazing. Yeah, that's amazing. And we had the one question here asking that they said that the tannins are very elegant. So, and how many years do you think this wine can age? Let's say for the Savigny, the Pernod Vergelès, the Clos du Roi.
I guess in a good cellar, you can go for 20 years with not any problem, all the wines. Maybe Pernod Hill and Corton can age more.
Yeah.
You know, we have still some old vintages here, but I can tell you at Christmas, one of my sister was born in 59. And we opened the Pernod Hill Léger Vergelès 59, and it was showing very, very, very well, and still quite fresh. The color was still red, not orange, and
amazing.
I really was surprised.
I had also this. I had last week also a Clos Vougeot 59, and it was really terrific. 59,
fantastic vintage also, but
nice. But then you can see. I would say also for both the Hill de Vergelès and the Corton Clos du Roi. You say 20, I can say they will start in 20, and I think 50 years in a good cellar, they can go as well at the domain, maybe
no
more
problem.
But they are really nice. That's what's so great about them. Yep. We can really have them and drink them. Then we can enjoy them now. And those Good. Who like the more aged wines, those who like them in the middle. So that's really nice. They are not, it's not like we open the bottle and we say, oh my God, why we opened it.
Yeah.
So tell us a bit about your white wine making style and then about this special cuvée.
Yes, well, the whites is a small part of our production. It's less than 15%. We do Savigny-les-Beaunes Les-Saucourt white, which is a village, young vine. We do the Pernod Vergelens Premier Cru Ile de Vergelens white that you're going to taste. My mother planted these vines. This one is La Vie est Belle, actually. I didn't know that. I'm sorry, but I think we should start with the Corton Blanc because this one is
no problem.
Specific okay. wine.
Yes,
it's
yes.
not very classical.
Okay.
You will see.
We'll do that. No problem.
I thought it was a classical Pernod Ile Blanc, but this one is a Pinot Blanc and it's very specific. So going to Corton.
We are. Changing it and צלל, תחליף את החבר'ה, מחליפים, שותים את הקורטון הלבן במקום, מתחילים איתו, ואחר כך נעבור ליין right. המיוחד. Alright, so we changed, yeah. no problem.
No, sorry about that, the confusion. No so I was telling you that we were doing a Pernod Ile Vergelens Blanc with Chardonnay, classical one. And then we go to Corton Hill and we do Corton Blanc, which is not very classical because it's planted in a red area, and Les Bressandes. And we have a very small plot, Corton Charlemagne.
So it's in Bressandes, Le Corton
more
Blanc.
Classical, more well known. So the Corton Blanc that you're going to taste is planted in the top of Corton Les Bressandes, 90% of the cuvée. And 10% on Les Chaumes de la Voirosse, which is on the south, just under Les Cortons Charlemagne. Really
les
on
Chaumes.
The south.
Yeah,
Les Chaumes.
Les Chaumes are. Yeah, so you're going. Yeah, it's very near. Upper. Yeah, you are. No. You were. Les Chaumes de la Voirosse.
Yes.
Les Chaumes de la Voirosse. No, yeah. On the. Down the screen. Yeah, on your right, not that much, on the purple part, but it's written Les Chaumes de la Voirosse. Yeah, here, yeah, you were, right, yep. On the purple tab, on the purple one. Yeah, and this is supposed to be red. Well, so 90% coming from Corton-Bressandes, which is very unusual. We are the only one who planted Chardonnay in the Corton-Bressandes, just for the story that why it happens, my parents in the 70s wanted to have a white wine in the domain because they were 100% red, and they wanted to have a small cuvée with whites. Voilà, we can understand this kind of desire. But when they replanted a part of Corton-Bressandes, they planted the top of the parcel with Chardonnay. So it was a funny wine, but actually, I mean, this was made for the family, for our personal tastings, and the clients tasted it and they said, wow, it's wonderful, it's so special, and so it's a wine, it's a Grand Cru. We cannot write on the label Les Bressandes because it's supposed to be red. But it's a Corton, which is not, you cannot compare with Corton Charlemagne, but it's more like the style of Bâtard Montrachet. It's big white, a little bit heavy, round, supple, with a lot of texture, and that is a very gastronomic kind of wine, I say.
I already got a bit hungry from the first taste you tasted, you know? It suddenly has like it's more fat and it has this mineral notes and the kind of like this honeysuckle, you know, yeah. those ones. Yeah. And it's beautiful. You taste first, the smell comes, the minerality, which is really nice. The minerals are really up on the first aromas, and then a bit anise coming. And then you have this like kind of pear fruits, you know, pear peach fruit kind.
Pear,
and then,
yeah.
Really nice.
Yellow fruits, right? Like peach, apricots.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's really I think the oak treatment is really incredible amazing. In the wine, because you do feel the oak, but there's so much fruit, minerality, flowers to go along with the oak. So you just feel this is a vin de garde. At the first moment
yes,
you taste it.
It ages very well. Right?
Yeah.
And how is for you the 2017? I mean, that's a really special wine. I didn't have many. I had a few Coton whites, but then that's really, really special one. Also for the location and everything. Yeah. And you can have, you know, a bit if you think about... When I think about Coton Charlemagne, you know, for Bouchard, the Coton Charlemagne is coming up from Le Coton. And then you have... But then... There is a bit more fruit. And here you have a bit more mineral kind and like the down terroir, and it's the real balance. And it's really like a Batard Montrachet
kind. It's rich, and yet the acidity is really, really high.
Yeah. Very high. So, and that is 17 as well we have here.
Was ripe, very ripe in 17.
Yeah.
But still, your description is I agree totally. This one starts with a very full body, very large, and at the end you have this saltiness coming from the terroir. It's quite funny to have so much minerality on a wine that is on the red area. That's what I like, is that it's full body wine when you start, and then you end with the freshness of the terroir. So you want to drink another glass.
Yeah, you want to eat, drink another glass.
Yeah,
and it's really coming, you know, from the end of the tongue, this kind of acidity and then the minerals, but still a lot of dry extract here in the wine. And wow, that's impressive. It's really, really special. I really didn't have so many.
Never, I think
both of the whites we have today are really special ones. Eh?
What about the percentage of new oak in the wine and the Coton Blanc?
Oh, Coton Blanc, it's about 20%.
20, yeah.
Right. And we use big barrels, demi-muit, coming from Stockinger, which are very good for the whites. We use this, and we use also a foudre, a big one, like 10 hectoliters. Yeah. And it keeps the wine a little bit on the reduction, that gives more freshness when you bottle the wines. It's quite nice.
Wow, so and both like the Stockinger wines, those that's a good choice. It's nice. You have the Stockinger ones, 600 and bigger ones, and beside that,
just retains freshness. I think the foudre is an amazing choice for maybe a more.
It's very good for the whites.
Yeah. Wow. So that's really, 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 really special. And you know, today it's such a nice tasting also, you know, beside having tasting, first of all, your wines and having you, but for the first time having like a vision about the hill of Coton with red, with white, with Pernod, with Savigny, all this area, which usually we don't taste so much.
Yeah.
It's really to have it, understand the terroir with three for the same vintage for the red, and then have the special whites, you know? It's not like the classical whites, Coton Charlemagne, Pernod Vergelès. We went for a very special tasting of this area on white.
Yeah.
Coton Blanc from Coton Bressane, usually white, and then from Pernod Vergelès, not this kind of the regular Pernod Vergelès, cool,
not of
gold
regular.
Cheese and very cold mineral here. A very special wine, and I think people are maybe they are still on the tasting with the white Coton with a fantastic aroma, so complex and elegant. Yeah, I agree. It's a really, really nice one. So, how many bottles of white do you produce? About 10,000 bottles?
The Coton Blanc, we do about 3,000 bottles a year.
Yeah.
or even a little bit less, between 2,400 and 3,000, depends on the vintages. And Pernod Ile de Vergelès, we do a little bit more, 4,000 bottles. And Savigny Blanc is 2,500 bottles a year also. So it's a small production anyway.
Really nice. Wow. That's a special tasting.
Very special.
We don't have it many times. You know, for me now, after a bit, the goat, the kind of always I have when you have the fresh, cool Corton whites in this area, you have a bit like the goat cheese coming.
I feel a lot of yogurt in the wine.
Goat cheese, right.
Yeah, goat cheese, yogurt is the same shit.
Goat yogurt, like cheese from yogurt.
Sheep cheese.
Sheep. And all right, so then we will move for the Pernod Vergelès, Ile de Vergelès, the La Vie en Belle,
which we had only the 14 vintage, excuse me, but
it's the 2014, right?
Yes, it's a very similar one to 2017, only by the colors, of course. So yeah. My confusion. I'm sorry about that.
So the story about this wine is a little bit funny, but voilà. When my mother planted the Chardonnay in the Pernod Ile de Vergelès, which used to be only reds on the 4 hectares, she planted 1 hectare with white, with Chardonnay, but not 1 hectare, a little bit less, because she planted 9 rows with Pinot Blanc. So we are in the 80s. She planted the first one in 85. And at this time, usually people wanted whites in Burgundy. They preferred the Meursault style, you see. So, I mean, the Meursault, the fat Meursault wines, heavy Meursault. And my mother thought that the Pernod Ile de Vergelès, if we had planted only Chardonnay, it would be a little bit too mineral, too tight, too much freshness. So she planted this Pinot Blanc, and she made very nice wines. At this time, the climate was not as hot as now. And in 2012, I decided to separate the Pinot Blanc and the Chardonnay. So I made the white Pernod Ile de Vergelès with only Chardonnay. And I let the grapes on the Pinot Blanc a little more to get a little bit overripe. And I did a skin contact maceration wine, because I had tasted before some from Italy and some other wines, what we call orange wines. And I was quite selected by these wines. So my idea with this Pinot Blanc, I didn't know what to do with it, was to make this skin contact wine. So it's made like a red. It's not a very long time in contact. I mean, it's like 15 days. When the fermentation is finished, we press and we make like a red. And then we go for the élevage in barrels for about 16 months or 18 months. On the lees, and there is absolutely no sulfite added in this cuvée, because I think the structure, the phenols that are in the wines, is much enough to protect it from oxidation. This is the story. And I made this with an artist that lives in Rue Saint-Georges. I made this special label, and it's a funny cuvée. It's a bit special, and it's only about 600 to 700 bottles a year.
This is the 2017 label in front of the 2014, as you can see.
Well, 17 is here.
Yeah. This one page.
And when was the first vintage you did that?
12, 2012.
Well, I tasted the 2013.
La Vie est Belle?
Yes.
I'm not sure.
You made or no?
No, because we had the frost.
So 14 you made. And then after 12...
We did 12, 14. And then... 13. 13? No, I don't remember now, but I think we did not because the yield were very, very, very low.
It might be 14. I tasted with the Athénès de Beirut.
14. Yeah. It's 12, 14, and then 17, 18, 19, and 20.
I think it's a really special natural wine. Really, 15 days, it's still Burgundy. You have this kind, you said before you had the apricot. So this is like, you know, the dry apricot.
The dried apricot.
Apricot.
Dry apricot, right.
All the time. Yeah, the Turkish make it.
It's a specific name for dried apricot.
צלל, איך אומרים?
מישמיש מיובש.
מישמיש מיובש כזה, שכמו של הטורקים עושים. מישהו מהקהל שייתן לנו, לדר.
לדר.
Yes, so it's really this kind of smell.
Yes, exactly. Leather, a little bit of apples, of apple, not apple
not
cake.
Not much cider.
It's not cider, it's like not cider, it's almost like roasted apples on a pan,
right?
Yeah. Like a pie.
Yeah, like.
What is funny is that it ages very well.
Yeah.
It's very interesting with the aging.
Yeah, it gets more fresh.
I didn't know when I started to do that, but I have tasted 2012 during the holidays, and the aging is really fantastic. It gets much more complex, and still with good freshness. I mean, it's kind of orange wine. It's still on the freshness.
Yeah, it's really kind of more. If we speak about Italy, is more going to the Valentini,
Emilio Pepe.
Emilio Pepe style. You feel the vinification a lot in the start, and when it gets aged, the terroir and the complexity is coming outside, which is very, very interesting as well for me.
I think it's also for the Jura, for a lot of producers in the Jura. Once the wines are bottled, they're let's say a little bit austere, but 2 or 3 years in bottle and they are just showing totally different. After 10, totally different. Yeah. We do believe that in this method as well as this. I think this natural wine system is going to a good place in a good hands, because when it's not in a good hands, it's just awful. For me, a lot of people love it, but for me, it's really, when it's not made right, it's just not made right at all. And I think here you get a very nice,
very nice
Vanatour with a lot of precision, elegance, and just not that austere. You know, it's the flavors are it's like, you know them. In a lot of Vanatour, I don't know the flavors. I never tasted this kind, and I think here you do find a lot of nice fruit that you can recognize. I think that's very important in wine, to recognize what you drink, and otherwise.
Then I'll just say something in Hebrew, and אנחנו ניפרד מפרנסואה בעוד כמה רגעים עכשיו. יהיה לנו עוד יין אחד לסיום לטעום, נדבר עליו אחרי, אבל את הטעימה המרכזית של השנדון בריאה היא סיימנו, שפשוט פנומנלית. So Francois, thank you very much. Our client would like to also probably say thank you for being with us. We are
that was
really,
my pleasure.
It's really, you know, it said that we cannot come and fly too much, but I think what we should do is that even when we will be able to fly, we should continue and make this Zoom, because it's really nice for so many people to see, because I think coming in the domain this time 13, but the next time we will see you, maybe we will be 24, 36 people. It will be a bit difficult for you to host us, and here like that, it's really nice, and
everybody's sitting tight, listening. Yeah. No problem.
So we are really making the best of it. So I really thank you very much, and I'm really proud to represent. We are really proud to represent your wines. You are an important and established domain in Burgundy, historical one, and it's a really, really, really great pride for us to do that.
It's so great. Thank you very much. I was very happy to participate with this tasting, and thank you for your very, very good organization. And you're right, we'll do it again whenever. needed. No problem. That's my pleasure.
We will do it very soon. We will manage to speak about the wine, see, and now we tasted them, you know, we made our reservation and we can to see what we can do. And one last thing, what is the dog on the labels?
It's a greyhound.
It's your dog?
No, it's not mine. It's the history of the family. It's the, how do you say, les armes de la famille.
Yeah.
It's the,
that's the symbol.
It's the symbol of the family, of the Nicolai family.
Amazing, yeah.
Oh, and the angels?
And the angels as well.
At the angel, you have to come home and you will see there are angels everywhere here on the walls.
All right.
We will.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, all of you.
Thanks very much.
Take care and all the best for the future.
Bye-bye.
See you. Ciao.
Bye-bye. Thank you very much.
Bye. Thank you.
שלום לכולם, ואני מקווה שנהניתם מהטעימה עם פרנסואה, זה באמת הייתה טעימה מיוחדת, ואני ממש שמח בפעם הראשונה לקיים כזאת טעימה, לשתף אתכם לגמרי במה שאנחנו עושים, בעינות שמגיעים לארץ עוד לפני שהם מגיעים, והיכולת שלכם להזמין עוד ולנו לנסות לקבל עוד יותר ממה שהיה לנו עד כה. אנחנו יכולים להגיד שהעלינו אתר חדש שמיועד ממש עבור הטעימות, לטעימות שלנו ולמחירות. הקלוק אוקשן הקודם הגיע דרך האתר שהיינו מוכרים בו עד היום, אתר של פודיז, אבל ההצלחה שלה וכולכם שהייתם שם איתנו ורכשתם והמשך הטעימות האלה, פתחנו אתר חדש, crownauctionhouse.com. אנחנו עוד נעשה שם המון דברים השנה, המון דברים בתחום היין, ואת כל את הטעימות נעביר את המחירות וכל האינדר שם, יהיו שם עדכונים, ונקווה שנוכל לעשות משם הרבה 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 דברים מעניינים. בקרוב עדכונים חמים לעוד אירוע קרוב שאנחנו הולכים לעשות. אז זה היה שנדון דה בריאי, באמת יקב ממש 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 היסטורי בבורגון, ויינות שלטעמים ממש ממש מפתיעים, ועם האדומים, עוד לא טעמנו את הלבנים הסופר קלאסיים, אבל הקורטון היה פנטסטי, לאוהבי מה שנקרא, זה באמת אינטרי לבל לאוהבי הז'אנה, ואני ממש, גם פעם קודמת שטעמתי אהבתי אותו, גם הפעם, האדומים הם ללא ספק לדעתי standing ovation בשבילם, זה אלגנטיות, אנרגיה ומשהו שבקוד דה בון, בדרך כלל הקוד דה בון, בוא נדבר על הקוד דה בון, הוא כזה מין תנינים קשוחים, פרי שחור, בשל, יותר מתקתק, צריך המון שנים, או שהוא ירוק כי בצורה מוקדם, או שהוא קצת הרבה פעמים, אבל כאן אנחנו באמת מבינים למה זה באמת הפסגה של הפסגה.
הפסגה של הקוד דה בון.
יחד עם עוד כמה יקבים, אבל זה באמת ייננות על, אני חושב. בואי, קלודר, וואו, מרגש. ממש. טוב, אז זה היה לסיכום שנדון דה בריאי. תהיה מכירה, כבר המכירה באוויר. אתם יכולים לרכוש, זאת הזדמנות פנטסטית, לרכוש את העינות במכירה מוקדמת. במרץ אנחנו נספק לכם את כל העינות. אולי זה יהיה כבר לפני, אנחנו כולם סיימו את השנה החדשה. אנחנו אוספים עכשיו את כל העינות מהיקבים את 2018, וממש בקרוב הם יהיו כאן בארץ בכמה וכמה משלוחים. ובינתיים, משהו אחר. משהו מיוחד, משהו ש...
משהו גם לדעתי
לסגור... אין מה להציע אותו עדיין למחירה, כי אנחנו עדיין חייבים להגיד לכם שעוד לא סגרנו את הלוקציה שלנו.
נכון, אבל זה
למה אנחנו גם פה איתם. הגיעו לנו יינות לטעום, ואנחנו טעמנו כמה, והחלטנו שאנחנו אישית מאוד אהבנו, ואנחנו רצינו לשתף אתכם, ושתטעמו יחד איתנו את היינות. אז היקב, תעלה את ה... תווית שלו דור צלל, נקרא בואייר מרטנו. בואייר מרטנו, ראיתי שם שאלה?
כן, היה לנו באמת שאלה אחת לגבי הסנסוף.
כן? מה השאלה שהייתה שם?
האם יהיה ניתן לרכוש את היין? והאם יהיה
לא, לא יהיה 2014 לקנייה, כי מזמן היקב אין לו 2014, אבל יהיה את מציר 2017 לקנייה, הוא נמצא...
2017, מה שטעמנו גם כרגע...
נמצא במחירה.
נכון? נמצא במחירה, מוזמנים כבר להיכנס בקרוב ללינק.
אז נחזור אליו. אוקיי, תעלה לנו את התווית דור, ויקב חדש שאנחנו מכירים, הכרנו, מכירים דרך חברים, הגיע אלינו, שמחנו ממש לטעום, אנחנו לא יכולים ללכת לבקר ביקבים, אבל היקבים באמת עושים את מרב המאמצים, שולחים לנו דוגמאות שנוכל לטעום, שולחים לנו כאן דווקא בשון דון דבריה, ממש רכשנו את הדוגמאות במחירם המלא, הבאנו אותם לארץ ככה, הצלחנו, ושמחו איתום כאן, זה באמת דוגמאות גם שהגענו, שהגיעו, שלחו, ורצינו לדבר יחד על היקב הזה. זה יקב שנקרא בוייר מרטנו. בוייר מרטנו עשה הרבה שינוי בשנים האחרונות. הוא יקב שעושה אלוואז' מאוד ארוך, אישון בחביות של 20 חודשים, חלקם 12 חודשים בחביות, ואחרי זה עוד 8 חודשים עד 10 חודשים טנקים של נירוסטה, או בקונקרט אג, זאת אומרת,
ביצי...
ממש, אתם רואים, זה נראה כמו ביצה, וזה ממש מחמר, אנחנו מדברים פה מזה, ובפודרים, זאת אומרת, בחביות עץ מאוד 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 גדולות, אז זאת העשייה של היקב. ליקב יש החזקות מדהימות, החזקות שמגיעות מפוליני, ממרסו, וגם קצת אדומים בפומר, פוליני, פרמייר קוקיירה, מרסו פרייר, מרסו שרם, טייה, נרבו, חלקות מדהימות, אנחנו טעמנו את הטייה, את הפרייר, טעמנו את הפומר האדום היום שהיה
גם מאוד מפתיע. טעמנו את המרסו שם, שזה אחת החלקות הווילאז' הגבוהות. זה המרסו שרם. אנחנו טעמנו גם את המרסו שום, הווילאז' שגם... גם קוש דורי, מושך משם ענבים.
למרסו הרגיל.
כן, למרסו הרגיל.
הרבה מרחיבות שם.
הרבה, נכון.
אבל אז זה היקב, בוייר מרטנו, פרנסואה מרטלה, היינן, ועשה הרבה שינויים, שדרג את העשייה ביקב, אני חושב שקיבל הרבה יותר אנרגיה ומינרליות.
פחות השמנמנות, פחות הגודל, פחות ה... כן עדיין אלוואז', אבל כן עדיין עבודה על היין, אבל משהו מעט יותר ניטרלי. אני חושב שגם שטעמנו פרייר, היין מאוד מאוד דיבר טרואר, אם כי פרייר היה מאוד מינרלי, מאוד חד, מאוד מלוח. פה אנחנו רואים את שרם, רואים את הגודל של שרם, רואים את, את הטקסטורה של שרם.
ו-2018.
שניהם ביחד באמת יוצרים משהו יותר גסטרונומי, יותר רחב.
בינינו, נשמח ממש ממש גם לשמוע אתכם. אנחנו יכולים לספר לכם שמבחינת התמורה למחיר היא פנטסטית ביקב. באמת פנטסטית, זאת אומרת, זה יקב חדש, סופר מעניין, עדיין המחירים ממש ממש טובים, זאת אומרת, זה יכול להגיד שזה כמעט האנטרי לבל שלנו יהיה ממרסו.
כן, ואתה יודע, ואינות עוד... היינו עדיין נאמנים לטרואר, אני חושב שזה משהו שמאוד מאוד חשוב לנו בכמעט כל יקב שאנחנו מייבים, שבעצם אתה טועם את היין ומה אתה טועם. אם אתה טועם פרנן וז'לס וזה טועם כאילו זה עכשיו, לא יודע, שמברטה נפלא ונהדר, אבל זה בחיים לא יהיה ככה ואין מה לעשות, אני חושב שהיינות שלנו מדברים את המקום ממנו הם מגיעים.
כן.
בכל יקב אשר הוא באמת ככה, אנחנו באמת פועלים לפי הטרואר.
סגנונות היקב, אני חושב במקום של, בכל זאת, זה הכי חשוב העשייה. העשייה של היקב היא הנאמבר וואן בחשיבות, כי הוא יכול לקחת את זה לכל מקום, ואנחנו כן עוקבים אחרי היקבים. ראינו את זה גם פה עכשיו בשנדון דבריאי, אבל בכל מקרה שבאמת לא העשייה תאפיל לגמרי. כן. כן, זה באמת איזה משהו סופר ייחודי ושונה, אבל לגמרי אני חושב שזה אחד המתאפים. אני חושב שיש כאן המון המון קולנס בעיינות גם מצד אחד, יש כאן את כל המין גוזיות, וזה לא מרסו שרם שהוא פלאבי.
נכון, זה לא פלאבי, זה העניין.
אתה מריח אותו, הוא עולה לך למעלה, הוא נעים לך, הוא לא כזה מין יורד לך לבטן ככה, ומה שנקרא גורם לך למשהו כזה קצת כבד ומשקל, אז...
מעניין אותנו קצת מה אתם
חושבים. מה אתם חושבים על היין? זה באמת מה שמעניין אותנו, מבחינתנו גם אנחנו יכולים להעלות את זה קצת ל-open discussion, תרצו לדבר, תרצו להגיד, אנחנו דור, אם יש למישהו מה לומר, כי בתור התחלה ורוצה להגיד, אנחנו בשיחה פתוחה, אתם יכולים לספר לנו גם על השנדון דה בריאי, אבל לגמרי שיחה פתוחה לקבל יקב ש... יגיע לארץ כנראה, ודעתכם עליו? ממש את דעתכם עליו, דעת הקליינטים עוד לפני שיש הלוקציה. אז אתם יכולים לפתוח את השיחות שלכם ולהגיד את דעותיכם על היין. רן שואם, יין נפלא. מיכל, מה יש לך לומר על היין קצת אולי? תגידי לנו. דור, תפתח.
הוא טיפה מוזר לי, אני לא זוכרת אם משהו מזכיר לי זה... אתם שומעים אותי?
בטח.
פינו גוז' או משהו כזה... הוא טיפה כמו פינו נואר, ויש משהו באף שלו שהוא לא... משהו שהוא לא שרדוני, כזה לפחות בחוויה... רגע, אני לא יודעת מה זה.
אוקיי, אוקיי. הלאה, אתה רוצה להגיד את דעותיך שם, שאתה מסתתר?
הלאה, הוא מסתתר בכללי.
לא מסתתר, לא מסתתר.
היי, איזה רקע, יפה מאוד.
זה הרקע של ה...
Magic moments. This is a magic moment.
כן. טוב. אני מודה שלא הייתי 100% מרוכז בתאימה, אבל... העיינות של, שעקב שאני מתקשה לבטא את השם שלו, שנדון דה בריאה?
בריאה.
כן, במבטא דרוזי אותנטי. יופי, יופי של עיינות. האדומים נפלאים, הקורטון טוב, הקורטון האדום, וואו, היסטרי. הקורטון הלבן, האף שלו לקח אותי למרצו של קוש. ליפשיץ, מה אתה אומר על זה?
אני מסכים. אני מסכים כי הוא גם מחפש את האלוואז' הארוך, הוא גם אוהב את הבשלות, ועדיין הפה עם חומצה, קומפלקסיטי והרבה רעננות.
ממש.
מסכים? יש פה איזשהו באמת דמיון לסגנון עשייה של קוש.
כן, אף שלא נערכתי.
אבל דניאל שתה יותר קוש.
דניאל, מה דניאל?
לא משנה דניאל.
והמרצוח שאנחנו שותים עכשיו, יופי, ממש יופי. לא הכרתי את היקב בכלל, יופי של יין.
כיף לשמוע, אני גם מאוד דעתי, זה באמת סטייל, ירון כאן אומר שזה יין מעניין, זה גם מה שאני אמרתי, גם בתור התחלה מין, היין הזה הוא מאוד מעניין, כי באמת יש לנו משהו שהוא מצד אחד ביין, מרגיש לנו נורא מוכר, ואיך מיכל אמרה קצת משהו לא מוכר היה בשביל, ואני גם מתחבר לכל כל כל הפינות פה, וזה גם משמחתי, כי בסופו של דבר שאנחנו מביאים, יין חדש, אנחנו רוצים שהוא יהיה, עוד איזשהו יין, אלא כן יהיה בו איזה משהו מיוחד.
מיוחד שאנחנו מדברים על אותו אזור, אותו זן.
כן, כן.
כל אותו דבר בעצם.
וזה באמת באמת יין מעין, ואני חושב שהוא מאוד מאוד כיף לשתות אותו צעיר. שזה דבר מאוד נחמד. אני חושב שזה עצם העשייה, גם האלוואז' הארוך שקצת מרקח אותו. ובאמת אני חושב שיש לו גם הרבה ספייסס כזה.
כן.
יש לו המון תבלינים, הוא מאוד מטובלן. בכל מיני דברים, גם הפרי וגם התבלינים, וזה בטח לא איזה קלאסיקה של מרסו שרם.
לא,
כן,
לא.
לא המרסו שרם הזה, זה אבל לגמרי לגמרי נותן לנו את, את הפאנצ' הסופר.
נגיד תודה גם ליובל לך. שעוזב אותנו, תודה יובל.
יובל, תודה רבה מאלת, היה מרגש לשלוח לך. היינות, איך היינות הגיעו? ספר לנו אולי קצת שנייה אחת, איך היינות הגיעו לך לאלת, למען...
היינות חוויה, הם נסעו טוב, כנראה שאומרים שהנסיעה לאלת עושה טוב ליין, אז אולי זכיתי בעוד קצת מהחוויה.
איזה כיף, תודה רבה, ממש כיף לראות אותך פה, וכיף לראות שהצלחנו להביא עד אלת את הערכה, ושטעמת איתנו, ומה שנקרא, טעמנו היום, מאלת ועד סביני לבון.
אחלה, תודה לכולם, לילה טוב.
לילה טוב, תודה רבה.
ביי.
טוב, אז תודה רבה גם לכולכם, היה בסופו של דבר כיף מאוד לטעום. תמיד אנחנו אוהבים שאתם מבקשים דברים לטעימה הבאה.
נכון.
אנחנו לא סגרנו אותה, אנחנו מתכננים גם אירוע מחירה מיוחד מאוד בקרוב, אנחנו מתכננים... רומיה 2018, מחירה מוקדמת בקרוב, מה עוד יש לנו? מוניירי ז'יבור, ג'ורג' נואלה, אנג'רוויל, אולי עשה אנג'רוויל, גם אפשר פה, מעניין מאוד, מעניין מאוד. תודה, אז יש לכם איזושהי בקשה מעניינת לטעימה הבאה? איזושהי בקשה, תמיד אנחנו אוהבים שאתם מבקשים, בין אם אנחנו נהנים לזה או בין אם לא, זה נותן לנו תמיד את הרעיונות.
זה בסדר גם לבקש רומנה קונטי 45. זה בסדר.
מתי עולה? מתי עולה?
אמרתי לדניאל מהטעימה הראשונה.
כל מה שהצעתם נשמע...
מתי עולה האתר החדש שלכם?
האתר החדש עלה? האתר החדש של בורגון, קראון, ממש, הוא גם באוויר, אבל הוא עדיין טבול, אבל קראון אוקשן האוס באוויר, יש שם כל הזמן יינות למחירה, יש שם, האירועים יהיו דרך שם, בקרוב אנחנו נקיים עוד אירוע מחירה מאוד גדול דרך שם נוסף ומעניין, אז מה שנקרא עדכונים ממש 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 בקרוב, הלינק מופיע גם בצ'אט והוא גם הגיע אליכם כבר במיילים, וכולם, כל מי שקנה קנה דרך שם, ואתם יכולים לראות, אנחנו כל יום משפרים אותו עוד, עושים עוד דברים, ו...
מה האתר? תגיד, תוך על מה האתר? איזה אתר?
הנה, אנחנו שוב פעם שמים אותו בצ'אט, crownauctionhouse.com. לכל הפעילויות שלנו שיהיו גם לגבי בורגון קראון, גם פעילויות קצת מחוץ לקופסה ומחירות כאלה ואחרות, ובורגון קראון האתר יתמקד אך ורק ב... יבוא, בדברים החדשים שבאים והכל.
במידע שיהיה לנו על העינות ועל היקבים, באמת הקראון אוקשנס זה יהיה הפעילות שלנו, הפעילות השוטפת, דברים שנציע, דברים שנעשה, והרבה הרבה הרבה דברים קורים ב-2021. כמובן, תודות גם לכם הלקוחות שבאמת איתנו.
בזכותכם, בסופו של דבר, ז'ניב ביזו אמר לי דבר אחד, דניאל, מה הדבר הכי חשוב ביין?
לקוחות.
אמרתי לו... יאה, ז'ניב, בטוח יש לך תשובה טובה. הלקוחות ששותים אותו, כי מי ששותה אותו, יהיה יותר ביקוש, אני אוכל לעבוד יותר טוב. זה נכון, ככל שיש לנו, יהיה לנו יותר ביקוש, אנחנו מבטיחים לפעול ולעבוד יותר חזק ולהביא עוד יקבים, ויש לנו עוד לא מעט שמות קטנים על הקנה כאן שמגיעים מכל מיני אזורים.
לא מעט,
כן, שלום. ואנחנו בהחלט בקרוב נספר לכם, אז... תודה רבה לכולכם, אפשר לבקש במייל ובכל מקום. תודה, תודה.
דניאל?
כן.
רגע, למה לא רואה את כולם? כזה מין...
כן, מיכל.
או, הנה. אפשר, זה... אולי צריך טיפ-טיפו לצדר, אני נמצאת בכל מיני קבוצות, אני מקבלת תמיד שלוש פעמים כל פרסום.
דור יטפל בזה, הוא ידבר איתך, דור צלל, והוא ידבר איתך איפה הדברים הכי נכונים, ואז זה יהיה בשיחה אישית. דור כאן, דור, טפל במיכל, דבר איתך, תסביר לה איפה להיות. תודה רבה לכולכם.
תודה.
ואנחנו נתראה בתאימות הבאות.